Welcome back to my booktube channel. My name is Sukhja and in this video I'm going to be doing something slightly different. As you all may be aware, May is Mental Health Awareness Month, and because of this I would like to talk to you about books that you can read in order to expand your awareness of mental health. But before I go there, I also want to talk about how reading is a great habit to form and one that will really help you out in the long run. Some of the benefits of reading. Number one, reading helps you live longer if you do it for a really long time. If you're able to read even for 20 minutes every day, you will add 2 years to your life, is what research has recently proven. I will be linking the articles from where I've got my information for this video in the description box down below. The second advantage, it is a really good form of developing empathy. When we were being taught for my masters, we were asking the professors what exactly are the marketable skills we as English majors have. The first thing that they said is empathy. Empathy really helps you in the long run, even in the corporate workplaces. Just being able to put yourself in someone else's shoes is a skill that is really valuable. We want leaders who are really empathetic these days and people who are very compassionate in their approach. So these things, they really pay off. So reading helps you sort of forget about yourself for an instance and think about what it's like to see the same situation or see a different situation from someone else's perspective. And in that sense, it's a really great way to pass the time as well. And it does provide a lot of enjoyment and pleasure. So that's the third point I would like to make about the benefits of reading. The fact that it provides enjoyment and pleasure. That is because reading is a form of escapism. And of course, in times of crisis and when we're going through really difficult periods of our life, it is great to escape and to momentarily forget about the world. And that's why we tend to watch shows. We tend to binge watch a lot of Netflix shows. A method that does involve a little more effort would be reading. But the payoff is really high in reading, because when you read, you also get invested in the book and you really tend to feel the same kind of emotions that the characters feel. And this cannot always be said as possible when you watch Netflix shows, which are kind of more like momentary gratification, and that's kind of like just a quick, you know, burst of dopamine. But when you're reading, the payoff is like this large dose of dopamine at the very end, and you really do experience things very strongly. And the fourth point is that even in situations, if you're not getting the opportunity to meet people and have real conversations, a book can be a friend to people in many ways. That's why there's this common adage about you're never alone because you have a book with you, and that's something that's very true, because when you're reading conversations that different characters are having, you inevitably feel a part of that conversation. You feel like you're not alone, you feel like you're with the characters in the text and you're going through the same kind of scenario, because it's so real. Because the power of the mind is such that the imagination that we have is endless and the possibilities are many. And therefore I think reading is a really great skill and it will definitely make you a better human being. It's also proven to be a good way to, you know, prevent dementia in the long run. If you want to take care of your cognitive abilities, reading is the way to go. You will definitely be able to safeguard your mental health as well by reading. There's something called bibliotherapy, which a lot of therapists are using alongside other treatments, which is really gaining ground these days, and that is being recommended. So therapists are recommending people who are dealing with mental illness to go and read certain books, because when they recommend these books, there are things that happen in the books which enable the person reading them to make sense of what the person is themselves going through, because there are things that people cannot tell directly, but the book puts it across in a much better way and you are able to absorb things in a very different way. Another benefit of reading is that it really helps you sleep really well. This is something I can vouch for, like 100%. The fact that I read before bed really helps me get a dreamless, uninterrupted sleep, and it's a very deep sleep and I don't have any trouble. I sleep immediately the moment my eyes start like coming down when I'm reading the page, and I keep it aside. I just sleep and I do not wake up in the middle of the night at all. Like, so it's a great thing to do. So the benefits of reading are vast and I highly recommend picking up a book. Are you wondering how to get started? Well, I have certain points for you. So we all have starting trouble, but what I recommend is actually browsing through a few blurbs, whether it's online, whether it's going to your independent bookstore nearby. Go to the bookstore and go to a section that appeals to you. Don't think twice. Don't think too much when you're picking out a book. if you find something in the book that really sounds interesting and you can relate to, even the slightest, tiniest bit of you suddenly perks up and it's like, oh, I want to read about that, or I want to learn what this person is, you know, going to be doing, and I want to find out. There needs to be that innate sense of curiosity, which a lot of readers have, and that's a great quality as well. So if you're able to pick up the book because one or two things in the blurb, you know, really strike you as something you want to find out about or you're interested in reading about, then just pick it up and start reading. So it's all about reading a paragraph or reading the first page, and if that sounds interesting, read the book. And you also will eventually become more aware of the kind of moods you're going through, and based on your mood, you will be able to pick up books that, you know, are in line with that mood. Sometimes you may be in for a romance, or sometimes you might feel like reading a horror or something. Depending on the mood, sometimes when it's raining outside, we want to read certain kinds of cozy books, and sometimes when we're going through a difficult time, we want to read feel-good books. So you will understand, and the resources are available on Google. Like, you will be able to find the book in no time. There's even an app called Storygraph, which recommends books to you based on your mood. I will link that in the description box down below. So basically, you can get started very easily. And how do you make it a habit? Well, I recommend reading every day for at least half an hour, whether it's in the early morning before you go to work, like on your commute, whether it's in the evening. It is definitely possible just before bed for you to read like a sentence or two. Even during your lunch break, if you can spare some moments just to read a paragraph. But you have to be a little more into the whole self-discipline thing. You've got to tell yourself, I'm only going to read for 20 minutes. And it's okay to sort of get out of the story and come back later, because, you know, you can always keep track of it. Like, it's going to be something that you're excited to get back to. So you can always, you know, get back to it another time. So that's what I recommend, making it a habit this way. You will find that reading for 30 days straight, you will make that a habit that will stick on for life. And most of the big CEOs out there also recommend reading, and it has helped them in so many ways. Barack Obama has a reading list. A lot of people have book clubs out there, so join a book club. It's a great way to get into the reading habit. Another way to, you know, stick to the reading habit is to form a Bookstagram account, to create one, and to get involved in the Bookstagram community. Bookstagram is a community on Instagram which involves a lot of people who take pictures of books, and then they write about books, and then they enter into discussions. So there are a lot of people who read the descriptions of books on Instagram, and then they engage in conversations about the book, and they're usually very meaningful, and it's a safe place. It's a great place to make connections and to bond over your shared love of books. So that's another way you can, you know, keep in track with your reading goals and, you know, see what everyone else is reading, and, you know, just be like a bookish person. So a lot of people have this notion, if you're a reader, you're a nerd, or you're like, you know, not really socially adept. But it is proof that readers are better when it comes to social cues. And you can learn a lot of social cues by reading, especially literary fiction. But right now, without further ado, I want to get to the recommendations bit. I want to start by talking about non-fiction books that you can read to help your mental health and safeguard it. The first book is Self-Care for the Real World by Nadia Narain and Katya Narain, two women who have written this book, and it is a book that provides actual, doable, actionable things that you can incorporate into your life, right from making a cup of tea. There are recipes in here, the food that you can eat. So the 365 degrees outlook on self-care and what you can do to incorporate little bits of taking care of yourself every day. So whether it's setting aside some time for meditation, or taking a massage, or calling up a friend and speaking to them, it tells you all of those things and how to do them in the best possible way, and talking about gratitude and, you know, how to build your self-confidence. And it has a lot of images inside as well, so I highly recommend picking this up. And, you know, keep it like a guidebook on your bedside table and refer to it every now and then when you're feeling lost, or you're feeling down, or you're looking for a way to perk yourself up. This is a great book that will offer solutions that are very actionable. A lot of the time we see self-help books that give us a lot of sermonizing, and there's a lot of, you know, preachy stuff in there, and you can't always action on those things. But here you have definite ways, to-do lists that you can actually start doing and start making part of your life, and that will really help you with your self-care as well. So I highly recommend this for everyone, not just people who are suffering from mental illness. I recommend that you read this book. self-care is just being able to do functional, normal, daily routine things, which sometimes we neglect, and in our busy lives with the whole fast-paced information overload kind of lives that we're living in, it is really important to make a conscious effort to be able to do these things in today's world, and that is why we have this book. The next book that I wanted to mention in the same vein is Ikigai, or The Japanese Secret to a Long and Happy Life by Hector Garcia. So this book is based on research. So there's a village in Japan where, you know, people are happy, and they're all happy because they're doing this one particular thing every day, and this task requires a state of flow, and when they're in that state of flow, it's really hard for them to come out of it, and that is when, you know, they are in their highest mind state, and that is also the time when they feel maximum enrichment and they feel really good about themselves and their lives. So people who have discovered their ikigai, their passion, it is said that if they practice this passion consistently, then they live extended lives and they live happy, fulfilling, enriched lives. And that is why I recommend reading this book, because it really tells you about you know, what you can do to find your ikigai and how you can make it a habit to practice your ikigai, and, you know, just doing that will enrich your life 360 degrees. So I highly recommend this for everybody as well. Now I want to move to feel good books that everybody can read. I have previously talked about A Gentleman in Moscow, and I highly recommend that for times like these, you know, crisis moments. A Gentleman in Moscow is about a man. He is a huge patriot. He loves Russia. But unfortunately, due to circumstances beyond his control, he is put into an exile where he is asked to stay on the topmost room of a hotel, Metropole, which is sort of like this five-star hotel. And he's pretty much under house arrest. He can't step out of the hotel. But yet, during this time, he is supposed to, you know, maintain his state of mind and maintain a calm and demeanor, not lose his cool. And this man is phenomenal. He is an example that is very aspirational. So that's another thing that fiction does. When you read characters that you really like or you relate to, or there's something in you that says, I want to be like this character, it makes it aspirational. He has this optimistic outlook, and it's a very thick book, but in the course of the book there are a lot of incidents that happen, and he always has a positive spin on them, and he never for once gives up and says, you know, I'm doomed, this is the end of me. Right from the moment when he's put into exile, he just believes that, you know, there'll be a way for him to keep sailing, keep swimming, and that's just beautiful. So I highly recommend reading A Gentleman in Moscow. The other book I want to talk about is The Unlikely Pilgrimage of Harold Fry, which also I mentioned in there. I'm going to link that up here for you to go check out. So this book is about Harold, who just gets a call one day saying that his best friend has been taken ill. So she is terminally ill, and that is the news that he gets. And he is married, he's in his old age, but then he decides he wants to show his friend that he's a really nice friend. And what does he do? He decides to drop everything one day and take like this you know, walk from one part of England, the north, to the south of England where his friend is. So he breaks from the routine monotony of his life, and he decides to do something nice for somebody. And in the process, he makes a lot of friends, and it's a lovely pilgrimage wherein he introspects, and then he learns a lot of life lessons. So it's a must read. I must recommend this as well. The third book I want to talk about is The Midnight Library by Matt Haig. I have just recently read this, and I highly recommend it. This is a book about a girl who is suffering from depression, and she has come to the decision that there's no better course of action for her but to take her own life. She's like in a really bad state, and from the beginning of the book her thoughts are pretty negative, and, you know, there seems like there's no hope. So one day she makes that decision, and it just so happens that it turns out to be at 12 o'clock in the middle of the night, and everything around her disappears, and she suddenly finds herself in a library where there are tons and tons of books, where she gets to decide whether she can pick up any of these books, because they're all titled My Life, and they're all different versions of the way her life would be were she to continue living, the kind of ways in which her life would turn out, the 100 different possibilities. So it's about multiple parallel universes and how your life, you know, in every second there are different versions of you based on the choices that you make. So she gets to stop and take stock of her life and decide which of the books she wants to get into. So it's like magic realism, and she does sort of get to live different lives before she decides which is the best one. So she has this option in the Midnight Library, just for one, select a life that she would like to live as opposed to the current one, because she is full of regret and fully depressed and doesn't want to continue living in her present life. This is just another exciting book that I highly recommend reading for both people who are suffering from mental illness and for those who are not. It's just a feel-good book, because the end and also the journey of reading has lovely life lessons, and it's well knit into this book, and it being fiction, it's just done so well. I want to get down to the actual books about mental health that I would suggest to people who are not aware of mental illnesses like, you know, manic depressive disorder or bipolar disorder, as well as schizophrenia or depression in general, and also things like isolation, loneliness and anxiety. The first book in this category is Eleanor Oliphant Is Completely Fine. It's a book that I really enjoyed. In the beginning, you will not realize the character is living in a depressed state of mind, but then you will eventually get it, and you know, it'll just piece together really well. So this is about a girl who has been living her life in the same way for a really long time. She's at the same job, she hasn't done anything differently, she's afraid to, you know, sort of do things differently, and she feels sort of resigned that this is the way her life is going to be for a really long time. She's someone who's learned how to survive, but she hasn't learned how to live. So whenever people ask her how she is, she believes also that people can't really, you know, say exactly how they're feeling. Most often when people ask us how we are forced to say that we're fine. That's socially accepted way of, you know, answering that question. In this book, you will meet this absolutely lovable character who is suffering from a mental illness. You will see her growth, and you will absolutely love the trajectory of this novel, and I highly recommend reading this. The next book in this category is M and the Big Home. This is for Indian readers and for people who want to read about mental illness in a more home setting. This is about a family, an Anglo-Indian family that's living in Mumbai, and it's about this couple, one of whom is diagnosed with manic depressive disorder, but she isn't taking the traditional route of taking medicines. So it's a work of fiction. It's written by Jerry Pinto, and in this book, M is the character who is suffering from this bipolar disorder, and her kids are also witness to this, and basically they have this day-to-day life scenarios and everything, and you get to see how it plays out when it's, you know, not being treated, and the kind of emotional and mental toll that it takes on the husband and the kids is very evident. Buying it is really worth it. I'm going to link all these books in the description box down below, so please check them out. And the next book I want to talk about is We Are Okay by Nina Lacour. This is a book that involves the LGBTQ community, mainly targeted to young adults, and I highly recommend reading this as well. This is about a girl who has recently moved to a university, and she experiences a sense of deep isolation and loneliness. So it is a really great way to sort of understand what it's like to be by yourself and also to cope with loneliness. You feel the despair of being alone when you read this book. It's also about how she overcomes this and how she sort of, you know, is able to come out of this with the help of her friends. So it's really interesting, and I would highly recommend reading this as well. Next book I want to talk about is a book that I haven't read but I've heard about, and I want to read this very quickly as well. This is called The Collected Schizophrenias by Esme Wang, and this is about a person who is actually diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder. So she's a professor, and she has written this non-fiction collection of essays. The best part about this is because it comes from a person who is suffering from a mental illness, and so she talks about her experiences being schizophrenic and also suffering from depression. I'm really looking forward to reading this. She dispels misperceptions and provides insight into a condition long misunderstood, culminating in a book of undeniable clarity and power. I recommend reading this to get a better, more, you know, well-informed understanding of schizophrenia. And the other book I'm going to talk about is An Unquiet Mind by N.K. Jemisin. This is a book about a person who is suffering from manic depressive disorder or bipolar disorder, as she prefers to call it. This is a bit more academic in nature from what I understood, but this is also something you can read in order to understand what it's like for somebody suffering from this illness, which involves a lot of paranoia, a lot of change in moods, and just, you know, being around the person can be taxing for other people. But then this is again written by somebody who has done a lot of research and work in the field of mental illness. And she's practiced as a psychiatrist as well. She's been allowed to practice despite being diagnosed with an illness like this. Despite coming out with this story of hers, which was a big risk at the time, she still makes a lot of really valid points about what it's like suffering from this sort of illness. So I highly recommend reading that as well in order to, you know, just expand your awareness about bipolar disorder and what it's like to be around somebody who has this. The next book I want to talk about is again a memoir by somebody who is in the Indian context. So this is called If I Had to Tell It Again by Gayatri Prabhu. This is a memoir that is about a person who has lost her father recently. She talks about the grief that entails and how she copes with the grief, but also her dad is someone who suffered from depression, like it took a toll on her upbringing. She talks about a complicated relationship with her father as well as the past, and she's basically re-looking at a lot of things and her decision in life to do certain things. I'll just read the first paragraph. 66 years of a lifetime gone. There would be no funeral. He had donated his body to a local medical college. It was part of his script, his fantasy about death. So her dad used to talk about death all the time, and yet he was very ill prepared for it when it came. He would show his hospital donation certificate to anyone who came to our house. No rituals for me, he would announce. To his mind, there was some justice in being cut up by medical students. He had wanted to be a doctor. There is his corpse lying on the floor, people constantly milling around, talking about his untimely, unfortunate death, while I stare at everyone in dry-eyed annoyance. This is another memoir that I highly recommend reading to get a better perspective of people's experience taking care of someone with mental illness. The last part of my video involves me talking about journals. So I know that, you know, a lot of people encourage free writing as something that you can do in order to, you know, engage in an activity of self-care. So journaling is considered that sort of activity where, you know, if you're feeling really emotional or you're feeling like very temperamental and you are feeling stressed, the best thing you can do is actually pick up a book and start writing all your thoughts down. Or even if it's on a computer, writing your thoughts down really helps. This is for everybody. This is not just for people who are suffering from mental illness. This is for everybody because it's something that we should make more effort to do, because the kind of lives we live in, you know, the kind of century that we're living in, can be very overwhelming for millennials as well, everything that we're going through. I have a few journal recommendations for people who get intimidated or find the page slightly daunting, find blank pages daunting to fill in. I have some easy ways of getting into the journaling habit for you guys. It is worth picking up this little journal called Q&A. 365 questions, 5 years, 1825 answers. This whole book consists of questions that you ask every day of the year, and you ask the same questions the next year and the year after that for a series of 5 years in total. So you can see your own self-development, you can see how you've evolved or how you've not evolved over the course of years, because our perceptions obviously change by our environmental circumstances and what we're going through. So you can actually see how the way you approached a certain topic or approached a certain question evolves over time. So for instance, there's this question, what would you want to study at school? So you might not feel the same way in 2016 as you feel in 2018 or 2019, and it's really nice to look back on how the answers have evolved later on in time. So it doesn't involve like you having to write for like half an hour or anything. It just involves you picking up pen and writing just for like 1 minute or 2 minutes, just thinking about a question and answering that over a period of 5 years. So it's like a cumulative experience. I highly recommend picking this journal up. The next book that I want to talk about is a journal called Burn After Writing. So this also is the kind of journal where you don't have to write endless blank pages, you don't have to fill them in. And there are prompts, so you don't have to be completely clueless. So the prompts are similar to things like, the one thing I don't mind spending a lot of money on. So, or, you know, if I had a brainwashing machine, I would use it on. So these are things that you can be really honest and you can, you know, no one needs to know these answers. So you can actually burn this book after writing, and there's not a blank space to accommodate the answers. And the nice thing about this is it makes you confront certain things that you wouldn't want to think about in real life, but confronting them and actually thinking about them can be a very healing experience for you. So I recommend buying this book as well. The next book that I want to talk about is called Wreck This Journal, which is not with me, but it is a really good journal for people who don't have, you know, too much time on their hands and they want to engage in journaling. It makes you, you know, like in this page, just, you know, scribble. So it says things like that. So you can just pick up the book and, you know, one day if you're frustrated about something at work or something, you just scribble all over the page, and it can be very therapeutic to release your energy in that manner. So there are a lot of different activities, like, you know, trace the circle around and in that circle write the things that you like or things like that. So it's a very interactive journal, and it has a lot of really creative, fun prompts that you can engage in, and there's a little bit of mixed media stuff that you can do as well. There are a lot of ways you can approach this journal, and it's very creative, and I highly recommend this as well. The final journal I wanted to talk to you guys about is Do One Thing That Scares You Every Day. So I had bought this journal some time ago, and it really helped me push the boundaries and get out of my comfort zone. So every day there are prompts like, you know, today I did this and it scares me so much, but I managed to do it anyway. It's a journal that would be really useful for a lot of people. So it has really fun prompts, really challenging ones too. It has quotes in the book that inspire you to take risks and to take a challenge and face it head first. So highly recommend all of these books. I hope you found this video really interesting. So let me know if you like this video. Please give it a like and thumbs up if you did. Subscribe to my channel. Thank you for watching. I'll be back with another bookish video. In the meantime, stay safe, stay sane, and I will see you soon. Bye.